Hey everybody, this is your boy Jim Austin. Jim Austin Online, man. We are just grooving up here in the stockyards, man. A lot of stuff going up, going down. So come on by. We're at 2009 North Main on the corner of 21st and Main, one block south of Joe T. Garcia. The coffee is always on. Lucinda loves coffee, so we get coffee every day. Good coffee. So come by and see me. We're at the Western Heritage Center on the second floor where we have the headquarters of the Austin Company, Jim Austin Online, our podcast show. Got two great tenants. You know, we're in tax season, so yeah. Miss Martinez, you know, is in there getting those taxes ready. But this is the Austin File. We talk about commercial real estate. We talk, let you know what's going on in the Metroplex. And we talk to interesting people. So I got a very interesting young man that just popped in into the thing from Oklahoma. He's a young cowboy. So you know I'm excited. So we have the National Multicultural Western Heritage Center downstairs, the museum. So he popped in and said, hey man, is this place open? I said, look like I need to open it if it's not open. So he came in and got a tour, but he's from Pawnee?
No, Pawhuska.
Pawhuska, Oklahoma. His name is Aura Brown. Welcome or to the studio right now.
Hello.
So he's a young cowboy and he comes in looking like one, acting like one. I told him it was $10 to come in. He went in his pocket and pulled out a roll of hundreds. And I said, I can't cash that. So I was lucky he had a 20 in there. So, but he's doing some amazing things. So, or welcome to the Austin File show on Jim Austin Online, young man.
Nice to meet you, sir.
It is good to meet you. Thank you for stopping by, and you're doing some great things. And you know, we'll talk a little bit about that. And you told me about your dad and family, and just finding out that 30 to 40% of the cowboys were people of color.
Yes, sir. Yeah. I mean, I've always kind of known there were black cowboys, but I just never really met any. You know, it's just, I didn't really grow up around any. I never really been introduced to any growing up, besides my father's side of the family. So, and most of them passed away by the time I was 10. So they were all old cowboys and stuff. So after they passed away, I really didn't know anybody. So,
okay.
I just kind of figured it all out on my own.
How old are you?
I'm 37.
37. Are you married or single?
Yes, sir. I am. I'm married. I got three boys. I have two boys from my first marriage. When I got married when I was young, at 18. I got a 16 and a 15 year old.
Okay.
And then me and my current wife, we have a 3-year old.
Right? Okay.
So, named Connor.
Stability, marriage.
Yes, sir.
Goes together. You know, it's always good to have a great mate. I'm celebrating 24 years of marriage.
Congratulations. It's a long time, man.
My wife, yeah,
that's a long time.
Got to work at it.
A lot of work.
You know, she's my heart. Yeah. She and I are founders of the National Multicultural Western Heritage Museum.
Oh, very much.
I know you saw her picture somewhere down there. Yeah. So,
pretty lady.
Yeah. Thank you. So, tell me, growing up, you know, of course, you went to high school.
Yes, sir.
I was homeschooled.
I was home. My mother was a pastor. My grandmother was a pastor, and so we were homeschooled after probably about the sixth grade. And
so
I graduated and got a diploma the same way anybody else would or whatever.
Sure.
And then I took off and joined the Army. So,
okay.
Yeah, so.
Good. My dad was in the Army. You know, he went in when he was 16.
Oh, really?
He wasn't supposed to do it, but.
Yep. He was sneakeroo.
Yes, he was the baby boy of James Austin Sr. My grandfather had 8 girls.
Wow.
And then had my dad.
Wow.
You know, so Grandpa said he wasn't leaving here without a
without
boy.
Without a boy, I know, right? You know, you gotta keep trying.
Shout out, Granddaddy, you know. So I'm James the second, and my son is James the third, you know. Yeah. So, yeah.
My son's the third also. We call him Trey, my oldest boy. So.
Okay.
My dad was Aura. I'm Aura. Aura Michael. And then my son is Aura Michael the third.
You know, and folks, we talking to a future Hall of Famer in here, you know, and as he was just telling me his story.
Big words.
You know, yeah, yeah, big words. So, yeah, but he's like, man, he's an actor. He's a stunt man. I mean, you know, Dean Smith, you know, the great Dean Smith, who was in all of John Wayne's movies, was a stunt man and still around, a friend. So we have to call him and check in on him. He's some 85 years old, raising Longhorns, about 2 hours from here, but just a legend.
Yes,
but you know, being a stunt man and already got some movie critics under your belt.
It's still just, I don't know, it just still seems like a job to me. You know, it's something I love to get up and do every day. So it's like, I don't really think of it as doing anything as of yet. You know, I mean, I believe we're all put down here for that, you know, to change the world, to make people better, to make ourselves better, you know, as human beings. But I don't quite feel like I've touched that part yet. You know, like, I just still feel like I'm doing a job every day. You know, it's different than cowboying. And, but I still cowboy between shows and stuff. When I go home, I still day work and ride colts and that kind of stuff like that. So
Sure.
I'll never get away from that. But the movie thing has just kind of become something of a lifestyle. Man.
Well, you and I need to stay connected because we're pushing the word out, the fact that Black, Hispanic, Native American, Asian cowboys were here back in the day.
For sure.
You know.
For sure.
Bill Pickett, of course, you know of. You know of Bass Reeves.
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, we working on a documentary. We working on a play, and we working on a movie about Bass. You know, how tall are you?
I'm 6'4".
6'4". Bass was 6'2". Mm-hmm. Okay, so you know, Ernest hears about us talking about me asking you about that role, because Ernest said. So that's his role.
Hey, Ernest is a great dude, and that's the closest I've ever seen anybody looking like somebody, you know, and he might have been like the later version of him as he got older and stuff like that, but he would play the part really well.
Really? Yeah.
And now Ernest is a great guy. I met him out in Santa Fe when we were doing the Harder They Fall out there. So that's when we've been friends for, I don't know, 4 or 5 years on Facebook probably, but we never met each other. Whenever I was doing stunts out there, he came out and he had a little roll out in part of it and stuff like that. And that was when we met at the hotel. And I was like, holy smokes, like, hey, finally nice to meet you, you know? And like, so that's how I met Ernest. Like,
he doesn't meet a stranger.
Me neither.
Okay.
I don't either.
I'm a
talkative person.
Well, I gave you my card.
Yes, sir.
Got my cell number on there. And before this interview, when it's over, I'm going to get your cell number. We're going to stay connected.
Sure.
Because the kind of things that you're doing is that we need to show our young kids of color that there's a life in being a cowboy.
Sure. That's why I did the cowboy show. That was the whole main reason. Like, it wasn't to, you know, if you won $50,000 or you know, or 50 head of cattle or the equivalent of $50,000 of cattle, you know, and but even though I kind of wanted that part of it, like I wanted the more money more than I wanted the cattle, because I was already starting to kind of get into the stunt game and all that kind of stuff, and I really wasn't wanting to have a ranch. I managed a ranch, you know, for 6 years. You're married to it, you know. There's no vacations. There's no cows don't take vacations. So it's. So they were like, oh, Aura, you gonna start a ranch? And I'm like, nope, I'm about to sell these cattle and take this money. I was like, pay off debt and go travel the world and go do cool shit every day. You know, like, that's all I wanted to do in life. I just want to do cool shit every day. That's me and my wife. Like, that's what we talk about. You know, be successful, maybe change some people's lives, change our lives, and you know, maybe one day, you know, be remembered for doing something great in this world, you know, like that's kind of, I think that's kind of the gist of it, you know.
Well, you know, up here in the stockyards, we got the American Paint Horse
mm-hmm.
Association. You see me up there on it. You know, we had to get up at 3 a.m. out to Lido and do that shot. So we got to be in the magazine. And
that's cool.
Then they just did a five piece spread on us in the Paint Horse magazine. But it's over here in their headquarters is over here in the stockyards.
Oh, okay. Yes, yeah. Yeah. I did see it down there. Yes, sir.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. If you get a chance, there's a this great woman named Anouk Krantz. She's from Paris, France. She came out to back home to Pawhuska, Osage County, and she did a photo shoot with me and my buddies. And then she went all around the American West, taking pictures of American cowboys, rodeo, and just ranch cowboys, stuff like that, and equestrian type folks too, you know, and she just put a book together that she just put out to be sold online, on Amazon, I think it is. And actually, me and a couple of my buddies were on the front cover of it. We're on the front cover of this book. It's already in Paris. It's already in London. I think it's in New York. And she's just getting all over the world.
They are just so she's done hammered a lot of beautiful about work. The black cowboys, because the French came in and they spent about a week, and they called me and they interviewed me downstairs in the museum and at the Coliseum.
Oh, really?
So yeah, there's a lot of connection with the black cowboys.
They seem to really be interested in like that American West life, black cowboys, you know, stuff like that. And she did a really, really good job. She did a really great job. And I think one of the portraits that she had done of me, a friend of mine called me the other day, is in a Dallas art gallery here somewhere in Dallas. It's a big, and it had a quote that I said underneath it or whatever. But I thought that was pretty cool to promote the black African-American cowboy, you know, just to put us out there on the map. You know, a lot of times you just don't see, and cowboys period, you know, because you don't really see a lot of real cowboys a lot, because, you know, they're so far out on those ranches and ranges and stuff like that. You know, they don't come to town like, you know, like you have rodeo guys that you see every weekend and all that kind of stuff. And people, you know, because I don't know how many times that I've been somewhere and I've had people ask me, oh, so you bulldog or calf rope? And I was like, I don't even rodeo, man. Like,
okay,
you know, and because that it's like, it's almost like a stereotype, even for black cowboys. Like if you work on a ranch, like I worked on a ranch my whole life, I'm a cow puncher. That's what I do. I punch cows for a living, you know? And so, but whenever I meet even other black people, like I've met other black people and they're like, hey, do you calf rope or bulldog? I'm like, I don't do either. I was like, I work on a ranch. And they're like, what? Like, yeah, I work on a ranch for a living. That's what I do. I take care of cows for a living. You know, it's like, Even the actual American cowboy, the guy that pushed cattle around on the range, you know, and all that kind of stuff, like they still don't even have the recognition that even like, you know, you ask anybody about black cowboys, first thing they say, Bill Pickett, or they say Fred Whitfield, or they say, you know, Corey Solomon, somebody like that. Yeah. All rodeo guys.
Yeah.
All rodeo guys. There's not one that mentions anything about any like old school cow punchers, old guys that were punching cows, like guys that actually lived it every single day of their life. You know what I'm saying? Like,
wow.
And so whenever I did that cowboy show, that's what I wanted to put out there. There's not just rodeo black cowboys. There's ranch cowboys. You know, I got 3 or 4 buddies that work on ranches right now. You probably never will see them because they're so far out on the ranch. You know, and they're black dudes. They live it every. They ride horses more than they probably drive a car. But they ride horses more than they walk half the time. You know, it's like these guys are straight cowhands day in and day out. But people won't ever see these type of people because they're so far out on these ranches and stuff.
Well, you know, here in Fort Worth, we got TCU and we got ranch management.
Yep, I was supposed to go to it and I went to Clarendon instead. And I got my degree in ranch management from Clarendon.
Young folks, great parents. If you go ahead and get your children involved in some type of equestrian, take them out to a riding ranch, but get them because there's a lot of money for people of color yeah. to go to school.
To go to school, for sure.
You know, so we talk, and so I'm going to call Dr. Buccini, president of Chancellor TCU. Mm-hmm. I'm going to get him a copy of this interview, and then I'm going to get the dean of the Ranch Management School, mm-hmm. and we're going to see if you can be the poster boy for... Ranch management.
I bet Clarendon was like that one. No, I really was. I was supposed to go to TCU with a buddy of mine. He graduated from the same program. He managed Tongue River Ranch for a while and stuff like that. He's big friends. He got with Poison Spider Company Ranch. Me and him were supposed to go to TCU together, and it was like. You know, the cost of it was expensive because it's TCU.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? It's sure. TCU. Well, then a buddy of mine called me and he was like, hey, you want to go to Clarendon to this ranch program that they got? I started looking into it, found out that it was pretty much the exact same thing that TCU did, except for it was a lot cheaper.
Yeah.
I mean, don't get me wrong, the Army was paying for mine anyway, so I've been in the military, so I was getting a GI Bill for it. But at the same time, it was just, I mean, yeah, you could, I mean, it's like somebody that would go to like, Tulsa Law, and then somebody else that would go to Harvard Law. You know, they're both still lawyers, but one has a more prestigious name behind
it. But you get the degree, and that's what's important.
Yeah, you get the degree because even the people that might have went to the Harvard School, if they never use it or don't really know what they were doing, then, I mean, they probably might never be successful in their life anyways.
Well, let's do this because we're moving on, man. I'm enjoying getting to know you and seeing what you've been doing. Tell me about, you know, you said you did a couple of movies.
Yes, sir.
And you're up here doing 1883 right now. You know, you're a stuntman on that scene.
Yes, sir.
Yep.
Yes, sir.
So go through what you've been in, and then you just told me you shot that movie that Elvis. It's coming.
Idris, yes, sir. Yes. Well, it started about 2018. I got offered a job to be a wrangler on a show, just which is a guy that they take care of the horses, and they sometimes they're in it riding wagons, driving wagons. And I did that in Savannah. And from that show, I met the stunt coordinator, and I went to New Mexico and shot The Harder They Fall. It comes out November 3rd, I believe, on Netflix.
I gotta see it.
It's the first all black Western directed by James Samuel. Great guy. Everybody in that production were good people. Regina King, Idris Elba, you know, there's so many good named actors, you know, up and coming actors, you know, Jonathan Majors, you know, there's just a bunch of just new young black folk that are coming up and that are doing some really big things. And but at first, you know, like, and I'm not gonna lie, I'm gonna be completely honest. I was kind of worried because most if you've looked at most black films, that Western black films that have come out over the years, Posse, whatever else, this, whatever, whatever, they were garbage.
Okay.
They were all garbage. I mean, it's like, you know, and this is my own opinion. This is my own opinion. And from a black man that has tried so hard to fit into a white man's society, like,
yeah.
Cowboying is most of it. I mean, because if you watch, you see John Wayne, you see this person, Sam Elliott, you see all most Western movies and the Marlboro Man's white, you know, all that kind of anything that you've ever saw that was Western cowboy, it was mostly white guys. And so being a black man trying to fit into that life, that culture, that lifestyle, like, and then to be respected by those men, by those great men, all those good guys that were cowboys that came before me, you know, those old hands that taught me stuff and stuff like that, to actually be respected as a man, not as a black man, but as a man.
A man.
You know, mm-hmm. Like, whenever I would watch black movies, like, we always seem to get the short end of the stick. Like, because when I grew up, you grew up watching those old Western movies with Tom Selleck and you had Ben Johnson, you had John Wayne, all these guys, you know, Sam Elliott and all these dudes. And so these are the guys that I emulated. There were never black cowboys out there on Western movies that I emulated because we never had good movies. Like, we were always riding around in all black and stuff, and like your saddles had silver all on them. And like, and then you'd watch a white Western movie and they'd look like some old busted up cowboys, like real how cowboys really looked, you know?
Yeah.
It was like we had to have some swag to our type of movies all the time or something, you know. It's like, And when black cowboys are just as broke as white cowboys, we were just as broke. Like, it's the same. We're the same type of people, you know? And so for me, it was like, when I first got, first did that movie, I was kind of nervous, you know, because I was like, is this going to be another black movie that's just going to embarrass the black cowboy,
right?
You know? And after I saw the trailer and everything, it looks like it's really going to be good. It looks like it's really going to be good. And I'm excited to see it. I'm really excited to see it now. But I think over the years, you know, like, you know, we've always kind of got the short end of the stick on stuff like that. It's like we want to be noticed, but then you take it too far. You know?
Yes, sir.
It's like it's too far. And then you kind of mess up the whole idea of what you're trying to promote, you know? And for me, it's like, we already live in a life, live in a world where we do got to kind of try a little harder. Don't get me wrong. I'm not playing no victim crap either. Cause it's like, you know, you get the respect that you give, you know, that was the way I was taught. You give the respect that you give out, you know? So if you want to be treated like a man and want to, you know, act like a man, then do man stuff. Treat people the way they need to be treated, and people treat you the way you be treated. You know, there's bad people everywhere, man. And you can sit here and play this victim or whatever you want to play, or you can go on and do great things in life and don't worry about all the other crap that people are speaking about this or about that, or, you know, they're out to get the black man, they're trying to put us down, they're trying to do this and that, whatever, man. Believe what you want to. If you want to sit in that mindset, you know how many rich black men there are in the world? You know how many mixed couples there are in the world? And you're going to be out here and tell me that it's this bad for us when 50 years ago, I couldn't even have married my wife because my wife's white. Everybody in my family's married to white people. Everybody, all my brothers and sisters are. None of us could have done that 60, 70 years ago. You know what I'm saying? And you're going to tell me that the world's this bad. And I know there's bad things that happen to good people. It happens. Like, welcome to life. Like, suck it up. Like, shit happens. But it's like, and I understand putting it out there to where we're treated equal. I understand that too. But at the same time, don't play a victim about it. So,
hey, my man up there said, we done ran through 20 minutes.
Oh, it's all good.
And, you know?
Thank y'all for having me today.
A lot of love everywhere, man.
A lot of love.
You know, your words are right on point. You know, I don't see color.
Yes, sir.
I do the best job
That's
I can.
It. That's it. That's all you can know? Do.
And I'm,
love.
And I'm in a hard industry.
Yes, sir.
Commercial real estate. So, Caleb, thanks for being behind the screen. I know you're going to get this chopped up.
Thanks, sir.
And much love to you and your future. And
thank you, sir.
I'm going to be right in there looking at that movie.
I appreciate it.
Okay.
I appreciate it. Thank you for having me.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Caleb.
Thank you, Caleb.